Today, the influence of reggae is everywhere, and a world without it would be unthinkable. However, until the early 70s, reggae was virtually unknown in most of the world. When it suddenly appeared, it was so striking, so different from everything else, yet so infectious that many people never forgot the first time they heard it. Reggae originated in relative isolation in Jamaica in the late 1960s. And when it was first heard in Europe and North America, it sounded truly revolutionary. Reggae violated all known rules about how rhythms were supposed to be put together. It was completely a new sound that changed the course of music, almost as much as rock and roll had done a decade earlier. However, reggae might not have caught on like a wildfire around the world had it not been introduced by an extraordinary man, who was both an extremely charismatic performer and one of the greatest singers and songwriters who ever lived. His name was, of course, Bob Marley. Marley died young at the age of 36 in 1981. Yet over the course of his relatively short career that lasted less than two decades, with only 8 years as an international charting artist, he became a household name across the world. Marley's legacy is immense. To date, 75 million Bob Marley albums have been sold worldwide. And many of his songs have become classics, amongst them I Shot the Sheriff, No Woman, No Cry, Get Up, Stand Up, Is This Love, One Love, and Redemption Song. Reggae influences have permeated pretty much all music, and Marley's songs have been covered by the likes of Eric Clapton, Nina Simone, Barbara Streisand, Johnny Cash, Annie Lennox, Stevie Wonder, and many, many more. So how did such a startlingly original form of music and such a startlingly original musician and performer emerge at the same time and in the same place? A small Caribbean island roughly the same size as Cyprus or New York City, with a population of less than 2 million people at the time that Marley grew up. And how did this form of music and this performer manage to take the world by storm? These are the questions that we'll discuss in today's video. When Jamaica gained independence from British rule in 1962, it took as its motto, out of many, one people. Of course, people from many different backgrounds bring many different types of music with them. And reggae eventually became Jamaica's national music. So its motto could also be, out of many, one music. The many music styles in Jamaica from which reggae arose include mento, calypso, jazz, shuffle, nyabingi music, and ska. Ska emerged in Jamaica in the late 50s out of mento, calypso, and jazz, as well as the rhythm and blues shuffle style played at blues parties and dance halls in the 1940s and 50s in Jamaica, often by DJs operating portable sound systems. Rhythm and blues from the US was another influence. Ska is dance music characterized by a quarter note walking bass line. The instantly recognizable guitar and piano accents are all upbeats. Jazz-influenced horn riffs and a kick drum accent on the third beat of the four-beat bar. It became the popular music amongst young people in Jamaica after the country gained independence. Hi-ya! In the mid-60s, ska transformed into rocksteady, which slowed down the beat and laid the accents on the two and four. From this, it was a relatively minor step towards reggae, which slows down the beat even more and keeps the accents on two and four, usually played by a guitar and or a keyboard. Unusually, the snare accents follow the third beat, suggesting half-time. The most common reggae and drum rhythm is called one drop, because it has only one kick in each bar. In a reversal of the emphasis on the one in funk, the kick on the first beat is left out. Instead, the kick, like the snare, only accents the third beat. As reggae musicians like to put it, play three beats and only suggest the fourth. The steppers reggae rhythm is a variation with a four on the floor kick. There's also a lot of emphasis in reggae on a heavily syncopated and often very melodic bass, usually played slightly behind the beat. The central place of the bass in reggae was a precursor of the huge bass sound that would later characterize hip-hop. And that has since become commonplace in pretty much all popular music today. Bob Marley was at the heart of the birth of reggae. He was born Robert Nesta Marley on February the 6th, 1945, in Nine Mile in northern Jamaica. His mother, Sadella Malcolm, was 18 years old when she was born, black and a descendant of the Akan people of Ghana and the Ivory Coast, who were abducted to the Americas as slaves. Bob Marley's father, Norval Sinclair Marley, was a 60 years old white and of British and Syrian descent. Norval Marley died in 1955 at the age of 70, when young Bob was only 10 years old. On top of this, his son and he only saw each other a handful of times. Norval Marley shaped his son's destiny in some important ways. His absence created a big hole in the young Marley, and the fact that he was of mixed race meant that he grew up as an outcast in Jamaican society. This most likely contributed to the emphasis in many of Marley's later lyrics, such as One Love, talking of unity, belonging, redemption, standing up for your rights, and introspection. Around the time that his father died, Marley's mother and he moved to Trenchtown, a desperately poor slum neighborhood of the capital of Jamaica, Kingston, that has become known as the birthplace of rocksteady and reggae. After arriving in Trenchtown, Marley and his mother moved in with Thaddeus Livingston and his son, Neville Livingston, who later assumed the name Bunny Wailer and became a big star in his own right. Neville and Bob spent time listening to the latest R&B on US radio stations and the emerging ska music. The two teenage boys also started to sing together. Life in the poor Trenchtown ghetto and being of mixed race was not easy for Marley. He needed to be tough to survive, which earned him the nickname Tough Gong, which later also became the name of his record label and recording studio. Most likely as a way of escaping the challenges of life in Trenchtown, Bob Marley had aspirations of a music career at a very young age. In 1962, still only 17, he recorded four songs with local producer Leslie Kong. They were in the ska style and called Judge Not, One Cup of Coffee, Do You Still Love Me, and Terror. The lyrics of Judge Not contain the poignant line, Who are you to judge me? And the life that I live. Don't you look at me so smug and say I'm going mad. Who are you to judge me and the life that I live? In 1963, Marley and Livingston started a vocal group together with Peter McIntosh, Beverly Kelso, and Junior Braithwaite. They called themselves the Teenagers, later changing to the Wailing Rude Boys, the Wailing Wailers, and eventually just the Wailers. Within a year, the Wailers had recorded a single called Simmer Down, accompanied by the ska group the Scarterlights and produced by producer Clement Coxone Dodd, also well known as the sound system DJ in Kingston. Written by Marley, the ska song went to number one in Jamaica in February 1964 and sold an estimated 70,000 copies. The group enjoyed several more top 10 singles. By 1965, the sextet had whittled down to a trio of Marley, Livingston, and Peter McIntosh, now called Tosh. Peter Tosh would also go on to become a legendary figure in the history of reggae. An album of their best recordings called The Wailing Wailer, produced by Clement Dodd and recorded at Jamaica Recording Studio in Kingston, was released at the end of 1965. the music was still predominantly in the ska style. Marley married Rita Anderson in February 1966. Finding it difficult to make ends meet with the £3 a week allowance that Marley was paid by producer Coxone Dodd, he moved to Delaware in the US the day after his marriage. He spent several months doing menial jobs before returning to Jamaica in October that same year. On his return, he found that his wife Rita had converted to the Rastafari religion, following a visit to Jamaica in April of 1966 of Haile Selassie, Emperor of Ethiopia, and regarded by many Rastafarians as the Messiah, also called the Rasta God or the Second Coming of Jesus. Marley had met well-known Rastafari elder Mortimer Plano much earlier, but now started to spend considerable time with him. Marley converted to the religion and started growing dreadlocks. The Rastafari religion gave Marley a place and a purpose in life. In most cases, the religious beliefs of an artist are regarded as a private matter and largely as an irrelevance. But Bob Marley's conversion to Rastafari had a fundamental impact on his music and lyrics, and on his status in Jamaica in general, and reggae music in particular. One influence was musical, and that came from the traditional music of Rastafari, Naya Bingi, which is a blend of 19th century gospel music and African drumming, and aims to bring about a state of heightened spirituality. The rhythms often also leave out one beat of a four-beat pattern. In other words, just like in reggae, play the three and suggest the fourth. The ecstatic and trance-like nature of Marley's later music and performances were also directly related to Rastafari, as were the political and religious nature of his many lyrics. It pays to briefly elaborate on the Rastafari movement. Rastafari emerged in Jamaica in the 1930s as both a religious and social movement. At its heart, it is a particular interpretation of the Bible with a belief in a single God called Jah, who resides in everyone. It is very much focused on Africa, particularly Ethiopia, which is regarded as the Promised Land, also called Zion. Famously, the smoking of cannabis is regarded as a religious ritual with healing properties that helps with the recognizing and the immorality of vanity and materialism. Rastafari became very popular among the poor Afro-Jamaican communities, in part as a reaction to British colonial rule. By the 1950s, Rastafari had become widespread in Jamaica. Its focus on black culture and the emancipation of the black people mirrors the counterculture movement in the US. Rastas also tend to be skeptical of capitalism and materialism in favor of small-scale farming and taking care of oneself and those close by. By placing his Rastafari beliefs at the heart of his lyrics and music, Bob Marley became the world's main spokesman for the Rastafari religion, and also for the poor and oppressed in Jamaica and elsewhere. The protest songs, dreadlocks, and cannabis smoking that were related to Rastafari would, a few years later, help to catapult Marley right into the middle of Western counterculture. His name spelled revolution and rebellion, and for decades, many teenage bedrooms have been adorned by two huge posters, one of Che Guevara and the other of Bob Marley. But we're running ahead of the story. Let's go back to 1966, when Marley had just started integrating Rastafari and was working out what it meant to him and his music. After his return from the US, he reformed the Wailers with Peter Tosh and Livingston, who both also became Rastafari. They founded a label called Wailin Soul M, and together with Soul Brothers released a successful rocksteady song called Bend Down Low. Bend down low. In 1967, the Wailers teamed up with American producer Danny Sims and recorded a lot of new material. Sims had an extensive track record in the music industry as a promoter, publisher, and label owner, and was known for his connections to the American underworld. Sims had discovered the singer Johnny Nash, and in 1965, the two of them moved to Jamaica. In 1967, Nash heard Marley sing at a Rastafari celebration and alerted Sims. Sims is credited today with being the first non-Jamaican to recognize Marley's superstar potential. He immediately signed Marley to his publishing company, Cayman Music, an arrangement that would last until 1977. Over the next 2 years, Marley and the Wailers recorded 211 songs for Sims. Although it's not clear whether they were purely meant to be pitched to other artists or demos for Marley's own recordings. When Sims and Nash moved to London in the late 60s, the Wailers sought out top-level Jamaican producer Lee Scratch Perry for their next recording project. Together with his house band, The Upsetters, the Wailers and Perry recorded many now classic rocksteady songs, amongst them Duppy Conqueror, Soul Almighty and Small Axe.
So if you want the big tree, you're the small.
Lee Scratch Perry, who died at the end of last August, is definitely worthy of a produce like a pro video in his own right. Perry was a pioneer of the use of the recording studio as an instrument, and of the development of dub music in the 1970s, and of the extensive use of studio effects. Later in his career, he worked with the likes of the Beastie Boys, The Clash, and The Orb. Perry is known as one of the founding fathers of reggae, and in particular for his work with Bob Marley and the Wailers. One example is the song Mr. Brown, written by Upsetter keyboardist and arranger Glenn Adams. The song is about a ghost, and Adams and Perry created an arrangement and a production that added a suitably ghostly effect. Working with Perry helped Marley and the Wailers to further define the reggae style. In so doing, they were also influenced by a reggae song by the Maytals, released in 1968 called Do the Reggae, which gave the genre its name. According to songwriter Toots Hibbett, reggae is a slang term for someone who is scruffy. It's assumed to be derived from the word rags or ragged clothes. Do the Reggae was produced by Leslie Kong, who had recorded Marley's very first efforts. Kong also was famous for working with Jimmy Cliff and Desmond Dekker. By May 1970, and still chasing major international success, the Wailers sought out Kong again and recorded an entire album with him as producer at Dynamic Sound Studios in Kingston, backed by the well-known session band called Beverly's All-Stars. There appear to have been some disagreements with Kong following these recordings, and the band reportedly was furious when he released the set more than a year later, in August 1971, as the Best of the Wailers. For one thing, they did not like the title. There was talk of a curse, which had got some traction when Kong died of a heart attack at the age of only 38, just a week after its release. In the 15 months between the recording and the release of The Best of the Wailers, the Wailers went back into the studio with Lee, Scratch Perry, and the Upsetters. At Randy's Studio 17 in Kingston, they recorded the group's third album, Soul Rebels. It was released in December 1970, before The Best of the Wailers, which is why Soul Rebels was for a long time incorrectly regarded as the Wailers' second album. Soul Rebels was a major achievement, and the first album released under the name Bob Marley and the Wailers. It's also the first album which Marley's reggae direction was fully realised. Perry's sparse production plays a major part. One of the musicians present at the time has speculated that the swing double accent of the guitar on beats 2 and 4 was the result of a happy accident with a tape delay, a favourite device of Perry, which was then imitated by the guitarist. Soul Rebel and Soul Almighty are some of the classic songs on Soul Rebels. And the influence of American black music is obvious from the cover of the James Brown song, My Cup. The opening lines of Soul Rebel speak volumes about Marley's mindset. I'm a rebel, soul rebel. I'm a capturer, soul adventurer. The album was initially released on Perry's Upsetter label, though the band was not impressed with the soft porn cover, and the relationship turned sour, also because of a disagreement over royalties. A year later in 1971, another album by Bob Marley and the Wailers was released. With music from the same sessions, called Soul Revolution, it also was produced by Perry and released on his Upsetter label. In addition to the originals, it contains some covers of Black American artists, such as Curtis Mayfield and Richie Havens. Perry also released a dub version of the album without vocals called Soul Revolution Part 2. Having worked with several producers and having run into some degree of trouble with all of them, Bob Marley and the Wailers wanted to spread their wings and be in control of their own destiny. Marley, Tosh and Livingston had always recorded as singers and worked with backing bands, but now decided to play their own instruments. Marley played guitar, Tosh guitar and keyboards, and Livingston percussion. They were backed by two musicians from the Upsetters, bassist Aston Family Man Barrett, and his brother and drummer Colton. This classic lineup of the Wailers was completed by Rita Marley and Marcia Griffith as backing singers. Marley and the Wailers set up a label, Tuff Gong, named after Marley's Trench Town nickname, on which they released a few singles with very limited success. By the end of 1971, Danny Sims managed to sign both Nash and Bob Marley to the CBS label Epic. And in February 1972, Sims, Nash and Marley flew out to London. Nash intended to record an album there, and CBS also wanted to record some Marley tracks under his own name. One of these songs was released and flopped. Later in 1972, and still in London, Marley convinced Sims to fly over the rest of the Wailers. They performed some concerts in England, but were otherwise at a loss as to what to do, and started running low on money. They stumbled on the most important event of their stay, and a turning point in their careers. They met up with the then already legendary producer and label owner, Chris Blackwell, who had co-founded Island Records in 1959. While born in London, Blackwell had spent most of his childhood in Jamaica, and he had retained a strong connection with the island until today. In 1972, Marley and Blackwell would have been aware of each other, as producer Coxone Dodd had licensed a few of Marley's recordings to Island Records. In fact, Marley's 1963 effort, Judge Not, had been released in the UK on the Island label. By 1972, Island had become one of the most prestigious labels in the world, associated with the likes of Free, King Crimson, Jethro Tull, Emerson, Lake & Palmer, Fairport Convention, John Martin, Jimmy Cliff, Nick Drake, and Cat Stevens. Blackwell clearly had an extraordinary talent for spotting talent. And when Marley and the Wailers entered his office, it did not take him long to work out that he was face to face with an artist and a group that, with the right support, would conquer the world. Blackwell decided that the best way to approach Marley and the Wailers was to show them trust. He asked them how much they needed to record an album. When they replied £4,000, he simply wrote a check for that amount. No longer short of money, the band went straight back to Jamaica. Blackwell was warned that he'd never see his money again. But when he flew to Jamaica a few months later and looked up the band, he discovered they'd used the money to record a masterpiece with remarkable songs like Concrete Jungle, Slave Driver, and Stir It Up. The resulting album, Catch a Fire, was recorded between May and October 1972, to 8-track, at Dynamite Studios, Harry J Studios, and Randy's Studios in Kingston. Blackwell and Marley agreed that their target audience consisted of white rock fans. So they took the tapes back to Island Studios in London, where the engineer transferred them to 16-track, so several session musicians could record overdubs. Muscle Shoals guitarist Wayne Perkins, who had played with Joni Mitchell and the Rolling Stones, recorded some solos, but asked for the bass to be removed while laying down his takes, because the rhythms were so alien to him. The album was mixed anew by Tony Platt, with Marley and Blackwell present. Blackwell later commented, "I wanted to add some rock guitar and synthesizers to make it more palatable to a rock audience. Out of all the records that we put out of Bob's, this one was the most smoothed out. It is a record with the most modification to the original sound. Bob's records became rawer as we went on." Catch a Fire was released on April the 13th, 1973, under the artist's name The Wailers. But later versions were released under the name Bob Marley and the Wailers. Sales initially were slow, as the music didn't fit any radio format. Yet over time, Catch a Fire has become widely recognized as one of the best reggae albums ever made. Bob Marley and the Wailers toured the UK and the US to promote the album and appeared on several popular BBC shows, causing a stir with their baffling reggae rhythms, electrifying songs and rebellious attitude and looks. Instead of In the US, they appeared alongside Bruce Springsteen's E Street Band and Sly and the Family Stone. In the same year, 1972, Johnny Nash enjoyed a big US hit with the Marley-written song Stir It Up, which also appears on Catch a Fire. Eager to capture on the momentum of Catch a Fire, a follow-up was recorded quickly and released half a year later. Burning was also recorded in Kingston and mixed in London. But this time there were no overdubs by session musicians to make the album more palatable to a rock audience. The arrangements were sparser and the lyrics more hard-hitting, as is evidence from the titles of the three core tracks, Get Up, Stand Up, I Shot the Sheriff, and Burning and Looting, which demonstrates Marley's amazing talent for writing seriously catchy, anthemic songs. I shot the sheriff, the sheriff. A year later, Eric Clapton had a worldwide hit with his cover of I Shot the Sheriff, which played a large part in putting Bob Marley's name on the map for white rock audiences. Clapton's version was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame in 2003. In 1997, a version of a song by Warren G also became an international hit. Unhappy with what they saw as the more commercial direction the Wailers were taking, and with all the attention given to Marley, Peter Tosh and Bunny Livingston left the Wailers and were replaced by keyboardists Bernard Harvey and Jean Roussel, and lead guitarist Al Anderson. With the addition of the backing vocal trio I3s, consisting of Rita Marley, Judy Mowat, and Marcia Griffiths, Natty Dread was recorded and released in October of 1974. The album contains classics like No Woman, No Cry and Lively Up Yourself, and has been called Marley's finest album and the ultimate reggae recording of all time. Although Marley ostensibly wrote all the songs, several are credited to friends and band members. Marley was in a contractual dispute with Cayman Music and did not want his songs associated with the company. Crediting the songs to associates also was a way of helping them out. Natty Dread sold better in the US than his previous albums, though Marley still had problems getting through to black audiences there because of the segregation of radio stations. Ironically, reggae was not recognized as black music by black radio stations. Marley's star was nevertheless in ascendancy everywhere, not least because he and the Wailers were spectacular live performers. Some of Marley and the Wailers' ecstatic dance and trance-inducing live performances were documented for posterity on the album Live, recorded at the Lyceum in London on July the 17th and 18th, 1975, with the same lineup as Natty Dread, only with the keyboardists replaced by Tyrone Downey and the addition of Alvin Patterson on percussion. Chris Blackwell called the concert and the album a turning point. It was released at the end of 1975 and was more commercially successful than Marley's previous albums and continues to be regarded as one of the best live albums of all time. Riding high on the success of Live, Marley and the Wailers recorded Rastaman Vibration, which was released in April 1976, and their first album entirely produced by the band itself. Previous albums released on Island Records had been co-produced by the Wailers and Chris Blackwell. The band added a third guitarist, Earl Chinner Smith, resulting in a more guitar-heavy sound. As with Natty Dread, Marley's songs were, for the most part, credited to friends and associates. The album continued the gradual upward curve of Marley and the Wailers' career, with rave reviews and higher chart positions and sales than previous albums. In recognition of Bob Marley and the Wailers' extraordinary live achievements, Rolling Stone magazine named them as Band of the Year at the end of 1976. Everything seemed to be going well for Marley, but on December the 3rd, 1976, the momentum of his career was disturbed by a dramatic event that strongly impacted him. 2 days before Marley was due to play a controversial peace concert organized by the then Jamaican Prime Minister Michael Manley, gunmen attacked Marley's home, and his manager, his wife Rita, and Marley himself all sustained bullet wounds. Marley insisted on performing at the concert, despite the inherent dangers, but left Jamaica soon afterwards, first spending time at Chris Blackwell's Compass Point studio on the Bahamas. After a month, he flew to England, where he spent the whole of 1977 and the beginning of 1978. During the first half of 1977, he recorded two albums at Island Studios in London, Exodus and Kaya. Exodus was released in June of 1977, and particularly the first side has more intense atmospheres than previous recording, incorporating elements of blues, funk, and rock, and the lyrics that touched on religious, political, and personal topics. Exodus contained many classic songs, amongst them Natural Mystic, So Much Things to Say, The Heathen, Exodus, Jamming, Turn Your Lights Down Low, One Love, and Three Little Birds. Junior Marvin had joined as lead guitarist, contributing to a different feel. Exodus again performed better commercially than its predecessors, reaching number 8 in the UK and number 20 in the US. It remained in the UK charts for 56 consecutive weeks. The album was critically acclaimed, and in 1999, Time magazine listed it as the best album of the 20th century. Kaya was released in March 1978 and much more laid back, to the point that there was accusations of the Wailers having gone soft. But it contained the classic songs Satisfy My Soul and Is This Love, Marley's best-selling single and another demonstration of his exceptional gift for melody and writing memorable lyrics. The album reached number 4 in the UK charts. A month after its release, Marley returned to Jamaica to headline the now legendary One Love, One Peace concert, during which he managed to get Prime Minister Michael Manley and his political opponent, Edward Seaga, on stage and for them to shake hands at a time when the country threatened to descend into civil war. Another live album was released in November of 1978, Babylon by Bus, mostly recorded in June that year in Paris. It saw two lead guitarists, Al Anderson and Junior Marvin, which contributed to a more aggressive sound. It has been called the most influential live reggae album ever because of the spectacular performances and the way it captures the ecstasy and transcendent frenzy of both the crowd and the band. It showed that concerts by Bob Marley and the Wailers were unlike any other. Marley also played Madison Square Garden in 1978, a concert that signified his much sought-after breakthrough with a black American audience. Two more albums followed, both recorded in Jamaica at Marley's Tuff Gong Studios, located in a house at 56 Hope Street in Kingston, that used to belong to Chris Blackwell. Both albums are more militant than his previous works. There are suggestions that this was a response to the criticism of Kaya, but it is more likely related to the still fraught and very violent political situation in Jamaica. Survival was released in October of 1979 and co-produced by the Wailers with American producer Alex Sadkin. It was less well received commercially and critically. Perhaps to turn the sudden downward slide, Uprising, released in June of 1980, was produced by Marley and Chris Blackwell. And it was indeed better received. It contained two classic songs, Could You Be Loved and Redemption Song. Could you be loved? Uprising was the last studio album released during Bob Marley's lifetime. He had been diagnosed with malignant melanoma under his toenail in July 1977. Marley rejected the advice to remove his toe and instead had only the nail and nail bed removed. He failed to have further checkups, and in September of 1980, he collapsed while jogging in Central Park in New York. The hospital diagnosis was that the cancer had spread to other parts of his body and that he only had weeks to live. He performed his last concert 2 days later on September the 23rd, 1980, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Marley went for treatment at a specialist holistic clinic in Germany, and perhaps the treatment worked to some degree, because against all expectations, he lived for another 8 months. But eventually he was told that they could not do anything for him anymore. He flew back to Jamaica on May the 8th, 1981, but his condition worsened so dramatically that the plane was diverted to Miami, where he died on May the 11th. Marley had received the Jamaican Order of Merit months before his death, and he received a state funeral in Jamaica on May the 21st. The music world, still reeling from the shock of John Lennon's murder just a few months earlier, had to mourn the loss of yet another great and iconic musician. But just like with Lennon, Marley's legacy continues to live, arguably even more strongly than during his lifetime. Marley's 13th and final studio album, Confrontation, that collates previous unreleased material, singles and reworked demos, was released in 1983. It contains the now classic song, Buffalo Soldier. It was a buffalo soldier in the heart. A year later, in May 1984, the compilation album Legend was released, which became Bob Marley and the Wailers' best-selling album, and one of the best-selling albums of all time. At the time of making this video, it was still in the Billboard album chart, where it had spent 694 consecutive weeks. Bob Marley was posthumously inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1994. In 2001, he was awarded a Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award and received a star in the Hollywood Hall of Fame. In 2010, his 1973 album Catch a Fire was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame. The BBC named One Love Song of the Millennium. Marley's music continues to be played and revered around the world, and reggae influences have been permeated everywhere. During the funeral ceremony in May 1981, Edward Seaga, the then Jamaican Prime Minister, summarized Marley's achievements eloquently. He said, "Marley's voice was an omnipresent cry in our electronic world. His sharp features, majestic looks, and prancing style, a vivid etching on the landscape of our minds. Marley was never seen. He was an experience which left an indelible imprint with each encounter. Such a man cannot be erased from the mind. He is part of the collective consciousness of the nation." The only addition to be made is that Marley makes a deep imprint on everyone everywhere and continues to be part of the collective consciousness of the entire world. Wow. Bob Marley came into my life as a little kid. I was just getting into music. It was the very late 70s. I am super little, too young to be listening to music probably. And he was everywhere. He was everywhere in the UK. The whole two-tone and ska movement owed so much to him. Of course, they went back to earlier late 50s and early 60s music, but Bob Marley was the undisputed leader. It's hard to even overstate in a million. I can't exaggerate how important a figure Bob Marley is. If you get this far and you don't agree with, well, if you got this far, then you agree. I don't know if there was a better songwriter and stylist. The thing is, there's some great songwriters out there, some of the best of the best. But he was sort of more than that. He was a leader of a whole movement. And I have worked with so many artists that name check him. The list is enormous. And they're not all reggae artists. Some of them are reggae artists. But I feel like he crossed all boundaries. With many bands that I work with, if they're into a specific style of music, they will probably love everything about that style of music. But they'll probably dislike other things. Bob Marley doesn't have that problem. I don't know anybody that I admire that doesn't think Bob Marley is one of the top five songwriters of all time. And he is such an important figure when it comes to human rights, when it comes to equality in every sense of the word. He exemplifies those things more than anybody else I can think of in the music industry. He brings people together, as you can see. Politically, he brought people from all walks of life. Unbelievable. He'll be sorely missed. And I remember vividly when he died. I mean, what a crazy kind of year. We had Bonham, Lennon, and then Bob Marley all dying in a short space of each other. It was huge, hugely influential period and made us very introspective and really highlighted just how lucky we were to have Bob Marley and his music. Thank you, Bob. Please leave any comments and questions below. Suggest any other artists. Let us know about any favorite songs you have of Bob's. Thank you ever so much for watching. Have a marvelous time. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, adios, adieu, tschüss, goodbye.